بس تبسم تبسم وخلي الهموم وخلي الغموم وخلي الضجر. الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Beloved elders and brothers and sisters in Islam, all praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat and salam upon our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his family and friends and all of those who follow till the end of time. We thank Allah for this opportunity to be here in this gathering of Jumu'ah, and we beg of him that when we leave here, we leave having been forgiven of our sins. Ameen. Jamaat al-Muslimin, last week we discussed the Quranic model of how brothers and sisters should live with one another. And we look at a few incidents in the Quran, including the incident of Nabi Yusuf, the incident of the sons of Nabi Adam, and the incident of Nabi Musa and Nabi Harun alayhi salatu wasalam. And we looked at how they portrayed the relationship of brothers and sisters to us in the glorious Quran. From that we derived certain principles of how to live with each other as brothers and sisters and what to avoid. Today, inshallah ta'ala, I hope to do the same thing, but not with brothers and sisters, rather with husbands and wives. We're going to look, inshallah ta'ala, at the Quranic model as to how a husband should treat his wife and vice versa. I begin by quoting from Surah Al-Furqan, in which Allah ta'ala describes to us who Ibadur Rahman is. Ibadur Rahman literally meaning the slaves of Ar-Rahman, the slaves of the Most Merciful. This is a very, very honorable title, because the slaves of the Most Merciful are given very, very special ranks of mercy by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And interestingly enough, that they should be called Ibad al-Rahman. The dhikr jama'ah that will be tomorrow evening after Maghrib is also called Ibad al-Rahman, and they've derived their name from this particular surah of the Quran. And amongst the descriptions that Allah gives of Ibad al-Rahman, of this great ranking people, is the following description. Allah says, والذين يقولون, they are those who say, ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما. عباد الرحمن, slaves of Ar-Rahman, they are those who say this dua. We've heard this dua many times before. This dua means, O our Lord, grant us from our spouses and from our progeny the coolness of our eyes, and make us the leaders of the righteous. Make us the leaders, imama, the leaders of al-muttaqeen, the righteous. Now we need to stop and pause for a moment and ask ourselves, when Allah Ta'ala teaches us a dua in the Quran, number one, he's teaching us how to turn to him in supplication. But what else is it that we can actually learn from the dua? Can we learn, can we derive something from the du'as that Allah Ta'ala teaches us in the Quran? For an example, in the Quran Allah says, from amongst the people there are those who say, oh our Lord, grant us in the dunya. رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا. They only ask that. وَمَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. But they get nothing in the Akhirah. But then Allah says, from amongst them there are those who say, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا وَكِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. This is a different dua, because now they're asking for good in the dunya, but they're also asking for good in the akhirah, times two. So from this, it's a dua that Allah's teaching us. Don't make the dua like that, make the dua like this. But we also learn how much concentration you must give on the akhirah as opposed to the dunya. So the duas that Allah Ta'ala teaches us, essentially is teaching us the objective. The dua that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us is teaching us how things ought to be. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for good in the dunya, for good in the akhirah, and to save him from the fire of Jahannam, and if that is the dua that Allah teaches us in the Quran, then that is a lesson for us of how things ought to be. We ought to give a certain level of attention to the dunya, about one third. But two-thirds of our attention must be towards the akhirah, because that is what the dua teaches us, how things ought to be. So from duas, we can actually learn how we are supposed to have our lives.
And the fact that Allah Ta'ala teaches us this is how we should ask Him means that it is something to strive for. This dua, my beloved elders and brothers in Islam, teaches us that the coolness of our eyes ought to be within our spouses and within our progeny. And that despite the fact that the coolness of our eyes often is found within our television sets, or within our sports entertainment, or within our surround sound system, or within our daily job activity, or within our hobby, within our sport that we play, within the family gathering where we talk and play games for the whole night, or within a holiday that we might get every year or so, or within our material possessions, or within obsession with a particular series on TV or particular show that we like to watch, or a movie, or in the things that we listen to. The coolness of our eyes might be found in those things, but the Quran teaches us that the coolness of our eyes ought to be found within our spouses and within our progeny. Here, we have to say that the Quran does not leave us with this is your goal and find your way towards your goal. The Quran actually facilitates the path towards our goal. For example, in Surah Ar-Rum, Allah Ta'ala tells us that from amongst His signs, He created your spouses. He created your spouses. The purpose of creating your spouses was so that you may live in peace and harmony with them. This is the purpose. You may find the coolness of your eyes with them. So again, He tells us the goal. But here Allah Ta'ala tells us how to get to that goal. He says that Allah is the one who places in your relationship love and mercy. Let me read the ayah. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Allah says, from amongst His signs, He created for you from yourselves, from your own souls, your spouses, so that you may live with them in peace and tranquility. And He placed between you love and mercy. Here's the secret. Allahu Akbar. The wisdom of the Quran. In our world, they will tell you, all you need is love. Isn't that the name of a popular song? They will tell you, all you need is love. All you need is love. Love, love, love. Valentine's Day type of thing. Hearts and roses. But reality will teach you that that's not going to work. Because you're not going to love everything. You will love many things. You will love the nice meals. The fact that you have clean clothes and clothes ironed. Perhaps the bread that you get for lunch every day. But you don't necessarily love certain habits that come out in the morning or in the evening. Or certain bedroom habits. Perhaps something to do with hygiene. Perhaps something to do with a certain sound that the person makes. Perhaps it is something to do with the way a person talks. The way the spouse talks to you. Perhaps it is something to do with the way the relationship exists between yourself and the spouse's family. Or the spouse and your family. Perhaps it is something to do with the way you speak to each other in front of other people. Perhaps it is something to do with the way the spouse has an idea of how finances should be dealt with, etc. Or what that person's rights is, etc. You might not like these things, or some of them, or all of them. You might not like them. And then realistically, love is not the quality that comes into play. And it is for this reason that Allah Ta'ala didn't just say, He placed between you love. Bismillah, go and love each other for all eternity, no matter what. He also says, He placed in between you mercy. Because for those qualities that you love about the person, the easy thing to display is love. But for those qualities that you do not like about your spouse, the quality that you need to display is mercy. The quality that you need to display is mercy. Because in all truth, each and every one of us are human beings. كل بني آدم خطاؤون وخير خطائين توابون. Every son of Adam, Nabi Adam alayhi salam, every human being in other words, is a sinner, makes mistakes. The best of those who make mistakes are those who repent. So if we admit that we make mistakes and we have faults and we have bad qualities, then we would also expect that our spouses are to love our good qualities and not hate us for our bad qualities, but rather show us some mercy. Therefore, we need to portray that same type of attitude. I'm not happy with what you're doing, but I'm not going to smack you through the wall. I'm going to show some mercy. I'm not happy with this particular quality or characteristic that you have, but I'm not going to try to bend you straight. I'm going to show some mercy. I'm not happy with the way things are going at the moment. You know, they used to be very good and I want to bring them back to the way they were. I'm not going to shout at you to the point where your ears burst and think that that is going to bring things right. Rather, I'm going to display some mercy, because perchance my mercy will lead to you understanding that this is that particular quality that I would like you to change. And you will work on that just like I will work on my bad qualities, and then we can move back to the quality of love. Allah Ta'ala says, in that there's a sign for people who reflect. Jama'atul Muslimin, in Surah An-Nisa, the chapter of woman, Allah Ta'ala gives us a very vivid description of how we should live with our wives. In very clear terms, Allah says, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Live with them in mutual respect and understanding. The word ma'ruf is a loaded word. It comes from the Arabic word ayn ra fa, arafa, to know. It means knowledge. When you see this word translated in any translation Quran, you will see it is translated as kindness. So what has kindness and knowledge got to do with each other? See, the word ma'ruf, arif, arafa, ma'ruf, it is that which is known to be good, but not in one person's mind, between at least two people. It is that which is acknowledged as the common ground between two people, at least two people. And that is the ground that you act on. That common ground where we both acknowledge that this area is what we both love. This area is where we are both comfortable. This is what I like and you like. Together, those particular factors will make for a good relationship. When Allah speaks about talaq and nikah, He speaks about al-ma'ruf, this area of mutual kindness. He says we should live with our spouses like that. And then Allah Ta'ala also says, realistic, the Quran is realistic. The Quran doesn't say, no matter what, you stick to that lady and you love everything about her. The Quran doesn't say, no matter what, you stick to that man and you love everything about him. The Quran is a very, very realistic instruction manual in a certain sense of the word. فَإِن كَرِهْتُمُوهُنَّ, says Allah. If you don't like something that she does, it's something that you really don't like. Not just one thing. For some of us it's 10 things. For others it's 1,000 things that we don't like. And I don't expect anybody to list them down and to start telling the person, this is what I don't like about you, because that's not good news. But Allah says, those things that you don't like, فَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا. Allah says, perchance you don't like something. There's something that you don't. شَيْئًا means something. There's only something that you don't like. But Allah says, وَيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. But Allah has placed in that person abundant goodness. You only see the one thing that you don't like. But is she entirely that one thing? For example, you have a spouse and she is a lover of the dunya. She just wants to shop till she drops. You are constantly forking out money for shoes and for bags and for clothing, and your account is always high. And this is a problem. And you dislike this quality about her, and you feel that Islamically it is incorrect. So you want to panel beat her so that she can come right now. Sy moet nou regkom. Sy moet luister, sy moet hoor. So you do whatever the thing is that you do. Allah says that quality you don't like, don't focus on that quality. Don't make your whole life about that bad quality. That every time you look at her, all you see is a shopaholic. Every time you look at her, all you see is your account going down. Every time you look at her, all you think about is your money that you must spend. Don't make your life about that. Because if you do, you're going to break your marriage. You're going to break her heart, your heart, and the heart of the family. What you need to do is take that, pocket it, and understand that it needs to be worked on. Focus, however, on those qualities that you love about her. Focus on those qualities that you expect and respect about her. Focus on those qualities that you admire about her. Because when you do, then she will see that you appreciate the good in her and that you are willing to overlook her shortfalls. And insha'Allah, in return, she will be willing to overlook your shortfalls. And wallahi al-azim, which of us can say here that we don't have shortfalls? We all have shortfalls. And we want our spouses to overlook our shortfalls. But how can we expect that treatment if we don't overlook theirs? And even worse, how can we expect Allah Ta'ala to overlook our mistakes if we are not willing to overlook the mistakes of others? Allahu Akbar. So this is the Quranic model. Look at how one incident in the Quran, when Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam had to deal with an issue with his spouses. Yes, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam also had issues with his spouses. And he also had to deal with problems. And he had the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like we have the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Listen to this. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam's wives, they started seeing that some of the richest sahabis, they were giving their wives fine garments, nice clothing. So for example, they were wearing Gucci and Versace. And now, being women folk, they also wanted some Gucci and some Versace. So they went to our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the Ummahatul Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers. And they say to him, the Sahab is wearing that and that Sahab is wearing that. And I would also appreciate these things. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam starts becoming perturbed. Because remember, he could, if he wanted, turn the Mount Uhud into gold. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy on him. He just had to make dua there. Bismillah, you reach. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose to live a certain type of lifestyle. He chose to be from amongst the fuqara and masakin. He chose to be from amongst the poor. So they were obviously wanting some more because they knew they had access to more. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was perturbed. How am I going to deal with this? I'm the Nabi of Allah. I'm supposed to deal with the problems of the Ummah, but here I have problems with my own spouses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, Ya ayyuhan Nabi, O Messenger, Qul li azwajik, say to your spouses, In kunta turidna al-hayata al-dunya wa zinataha, if you prefer the life of the dunya and its adornments, fata'alain, then come. Umatti'kunna, I will give it to you. Wa usarrihkunna, but then I will leave you. Sarahan jamila, a beautiful leaving. I'm not going to throw you off the cliff. I'm not going to beat you blue. I'm not going to send you to Red Cross because of the abuse, because there's a problem. No, I'm going to leave you in a beautiful manner. Because it is unbefitting of a Nabi of Allah to have a combination of the love of the dunya in his life and his higher purpose. Look at the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam must deal with this particular incident. And of course, they unanimously chose to forego the luxuries of the dunya and to choose a life with the beloved of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But it goes to show that no person, no matter how learned, no matter how pious, is free of issues within their marriage. That is why the Quran is emphatic about these issues and how to deal with them. Again, for the qualities you love, display the love. For the qualities you don't like, display the mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also had to tell the believers that, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, إِنَّ مِنْ أَزْوَاجِكُمْ وَأَوْلَادِكُمْ عَدُوًّا لَكُمْ فَاحْذَرُوهُمْ Ya salam. This verse, if you don't understand it correctly, could get you into a heck of a lot of trouble with your spouses. Because this verse says, O believers, verily from your spouses and from your children, they are enemies for you, so beware of them. Ya Rab. Ya Rab. They are enemies for you, so beware of them. The explanation of this verse is not that all of our wives are our enemies. Even though some of us might be thinking, yeah, that's not the case. If you have a wife that accompanies you on the Sirat al-Mustaqim, then she's not an enemy for you. She's not an enemy for you. If you have a wife that is prohibiting you and preventing you from the Sirat al-Mustaqim and leading you this way and leading you that way, and because of what you feel for her, you allow it to happen, then that is an enemy for you. And this is what the Quran is saying. It's got nothing to do with love here. Allah Ta'ala's relationship with us comes first. If there is a hurdle between ourselves and Allah, even if it be our own family, then that hurdle needs to be flattened. That hurdle needs to be overcome. And there is no compromise. The Quran doesn't say, it's okay, just give it in, you know, give in for a while. No, the Quran says they are enemies for you if they are preventing you from Allah. But Allah says, even when they are enemies for you, don't treat them harshly. Don't treat them like they are animals. Don't beat them to a pulp. Don't be like a tyrant and the oppressed person. Allah says, وَإِن تَعْفُوا وَتَصْفَحُوا وَتَغْفِرُوا. If you pardon and overlook and forgive, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, then Allah Ta'ala will be the most forgiving and most merciful for you. You show them mercy, you forgive them, you overlook their faults, and Allah Ta'ala will forgive you, show you mercy, and overlook your faults, insha'Allah. Jama'atul Muslimin, the beauty of having a good spouse, on the other hand, this is now when your spouse is an enemy for you, and I said, we need to take that into consideration. But if you have a good spouse, Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Yasin, that what will happen when you have a good spouse? هُمْ وَأَزْوَاجُهُمْ فِي ظِلَالٍ عَلَى الْأَرَائِكِ مُتَّكِئُونَ. They and their spouses will be reclining on couches in Jannah. Just like you lived well in the dunya, Allah Ta'ala will allow you to live well in the Jannah. I'm not going to get into the issues of now, you're not going to be just with her and there's other spouses involved. Wallahu a'lam. Let's leave it at that. You'll go to Jannah together. It will be said to you, Udukhulul Jannata antum wa azwajukum. Enter into Jannah, you and your spouses. Allahu Akbar. In fact, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to treat our spouses as though they are fragile beings. The description is that they were created from a rib. Some women take offense to this. Why? Allah knows best. But if you look at the nature of a rib in a man is that which protects his most vulnerable parts, the organs. Without that rib, you'll easily be penetrated here and you could die. A rib protects you, and it is something that you will protect as well. But the idea is that the rib comes with a curve. The rib comes with a curve. In Cape Town, you call it a krill. Say it a krill. Every wife, every husband, hey, and say it, hello, hello, krille. They got their own little unique thing about them that you're not too au fait with. You've got that curve, you've got that curl. So they created from this rib. But the Prophet ﷺ said that the highest part of the rib is the most curled part. It's the most curled part. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you should treat her like that. If you're going to try to bend the rib straight, what's going to happen? You're going to break the rib. And if you break the rib, you break the lady. That's divorce. But if you love her, then know that you're loving her with the krill. You must accept it. You took her with the krill, so don't try to change the krill. It's there. You've also got a girl, and she loves you with that. Love for what you love, mercy for what you don't. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's dying words, one of the things that he said as his dying instruction was, Istaw bin nisa. Treat your women folk with kindness. Live with them with kindness. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us that akmalul mu'minina imanan ahsanuhum khuluqan. The best believers are those who have the best character. You can be making tahajjud salah every night. If there are people who regard you as somebody with bad akhlaq, you can forget about your position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You think big turban, groot abaya, groot dukie om die kop, And now you must be pious. But then you walk past people, you don't greet this one because they're not as pious as you. You don't greet that one because they're not as pious as you, as learned as you. And you just carry on and you miss the man. Bad akhlaq, that piety amounts to nothing in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the deen, Nabi Muhammad's mission was to come and teach us good akhlaq. So if you miss the point, you miss the point completely. But now who are those who are the best with akhlaq? Because you get many people with good akhlaq, but who has the best akhlaq? Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Khiyarukum, khiyarukum linisa'ihim." The best of those are the best to their spouses. Ya salam. Because Jamaatul Muslimin, you come to the masjid, you go to the mall, you go to work even, it's easy to put on the mask, ek is 'n goeie persoon. And you treat everybody nice. You treat everybody nice with a smile and you don't get angry and you got lots of sabr. But when you come home, the mask is off and the lion comes out. Waar's die kos? Waar's my tea? The lion comes out. So the mask comes off, and that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you can treat your spouses with good character, that shows that you are a true mu'min with the best of character. May Allah Ta'ala make us of those. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us that the best thing you could possibly have in your life in this dunya is not a big house or lots of children or lots of money or a nice car. The best that you can have in this dunya is al-mar'atu salihatu, a suitable spouse. Many people translate this as a pious spouse, but that wouldn't make the hadith true. Because if you have a sinful man, he doesn't even perform salah, and his wife is super pious, is that marriage going to work? The first thing she's going to say, "Can't I with you, Livani? I can't live with you. This never going to work." But if you have a suitable spouse, you both make salah 5 times a day on time, and you accompany one another on the pathway to piety, then inshallah, you have the best that this dunya can offer. You have the best that this dunya can offer. If you don't have a suitable spouse, my brothers and sisters in Islam, make sabr. Because this dunya is only for so long. And then we go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't say, because I've not got a suitable spouse, I will treat her as I wish to treat her. And then on the day of Qiyamah, we'll be answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We end off with the following advices. These are points that some great alim has taken out, looking at the relationships between husbands and wives. Number one, and this is only for brothers towards their wives, what does she want from you? This is a big question. What does she want? Above all, she wants your love and devotion. She just wants to be the apple of your eye. That's it. She doesn't want necessarily, in some cases, expensive flowers and expensive dates and expensive this and expensive that. She just wants to be the center of attention. Number two, she's bored of you doing the same thing day in and day out. The same times, the same places, the same people, the same things. She's going out of her mind of boredom. So do something different now and then to surprise her. Bring a chocolate home. A PS doesn't cost that much money. Can't afford a PS, then inshallah something smaller, a chomp maybe. Bring a bunch of flowers home. Even if it means you must go ask one of your friends if you can pick the flowers from their garden. Just be spontaneous now and then. Instead of saying, well, what we do on a Friday night is normally X, Y, Z. Say, tonight, my darling, we will do something a bit different. We're going to go out a bit. Being pious doesn't mean being boring. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam spent time with his spouses. He used to take races with Aisha. Which of us here can say we took a race with our spouse in the last year? Subhanallah. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would take food and put it into the mouth of his spouse, and his wife would do the same. If we must do that with our spouse, she'll say, "Sis, ya, anas fil khatbas." For example, we need to see the fact that Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's life was filled with piety, but halal fun at the same time. Number three, she wants to be appreciated. If she makes you food every day and you didn't say shukran for that food for the last 20 years, you're in trouble. Because she's not doing it for you anymore. She's just doing it because she feels that she's a prisoner and she has to do it. Now and then say, subhanallah, dikos. Dikos. Dis amper soos dikos van die Jannah. Now and then say that, you know, I appreciate what you're doing for me, my beloved wife. May Allah Ta'ala grant you the highest place in Jannah. I appreciate what you do for me on a daily basis. I know I don't say it because I think that we understand, but I'm saying it now. I appreciate everything. She wants to feel special. She wants to know that you acknowledge. And this applies even to those who are married for 30, 40, 50 years. A simple shukran will go a long way. Number four, know that she, especially if you're young, is insanely jealous. She's insanely jealous. So don't try to play with that. If the wives of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were jealous, then how can we expect that our own wives mustn't be jealous? So don't comment on the beautiful star on the TV, or the lady that walked past, or the food of another lady that you tasted, or your ex-wife, for example, or another wife if you're in that situation, or your mother even, or her mother, or her sister, or somebody else. Because the moment you're going to compare her, you're in deep trouble. May Allah save us, Jamaat al-Muslimin. Now, number five is, she wants you to take her hand and walk on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. The dua we read at the beginning was, Rabbana hablana min azwajina wa dhurriyatina kurrata a'yun wa ja'alna lil-muttaqina imama. Give us the coolness of our eyes in our spouses and make us the leaders of the righteous. She wants you to be an imam. If you can't show your spouse that you are a leader and that you can take the role of Islamic welfare in your house and of Islamic well-being in your house, trust me, she's going to lose confidence in you. If you can't show that you are the one that says, it is time for us to go and perform salah. It is time for you now to start dressing more appropriately like a Muslimah, in a nice way with wisdom. And it is time for us to start living more righteous lives. Then she will start losing confidence in you, thinking that the only value you have is material value. May Allah save us. Number six, we like to think that they are at fault. And say blaynag. Say blaynag. But we have to sometimes ask ourselves, why? Perhaps we are the cause of that. Lastly, more than anything else, a woman wants one thing from a man, and that is, she does not want to get hurt. That's the one main thing that a woman wants. When she married you, it wasn't just all about we're going to have fun in this relationship. She looked for a home, a safety, something that she can come home to and feel secure. If she doesn't find that within you, that's a big, big problem. If she doesn't feel safe with you as the man of the house, that's a big problem. May Allah Ta'ala grant us successful marriages, inshallah. It will take us to Jannah. And Allah Ta'ala grant us love and mercy in our relationships. Sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Wa akhiru da'wana. Alhamdulillah. Rabbil Alameen.
تبسم تبسم وخل الهموم وخل الغموم وخل الضجر.